Thanks. Can everyone hear me first? Yes, good. All the ones who can't say so, right? First, let me give you some background. I'm not a specialist in healthcare. I'm really a general economist and commentator. I have an economics textbook, you know, that's been around for some 30 years. I've written 40 books on a variety of different subjects. And it really is bringing economic knowledge down to sort of everyday life. So I've always sort of felt that I fit with AIER, you know, sort of here, because, you know, so that's a concern. And I think a really important issue, you know, that we have to do. You know, so they called up and said, would you come down? You know, so it's a wonderful place to be here. I said, yes. I said, what do you want me to talk about? I said, well, something that'll be of interest to people. I said, most of the stuff I do isn't of interest to people. They said, well, how about doing something on healthcare? And I was working on an article. I do a regular column for the Eastern Economic Journal. And I was working on a column, an economics with attitude column, which sort of raises issues to get people's dander up. And so I said, I'm working on this column on healthcare. And so I'll do something on some thoughts on healthcare. They said, fine, but we got to change it, you know, something a little more sexy that'll get in a few people. So, you know, hence we got the title here, which is on, you know, sort of how to reform or reforming the Affordable Healthcare Act. The chances of actually politically reforming the Affordable Healthcare Act are nil. And so I'm really not going to talk about what is politically possible. I used to be interested in politics. I'm not anymore. Far not. You know, sort of, and it goes back sort of early on when I, you know, sort of was invited up to sort of Washington to sort of talk, because I had written some papers which were kind of interesting and everything else. And then I discovered how politics actually works. I'm an academic, and you know, sort of I stayed there. I don't know politics and I stay away from politics. But that allows me to say things that other people can't say. And of course, that's what made it next to impossible for me or anybody like me. Maybe Donald Trump is a little like me, but in quite different ways, you know, sort of not to be a politician, which sort of raises a number of issues. But I thought the topic that I talk about on healthcare reform and the issues I'm going to raise sort of fit with AIER, because they relate to a methodology and a way of thinking that I believe is consistent with Colonel Harwood's methodology, you know, sort of if we're going back. And that's an essentially what I call a pragmatic engineering approach to economics. Theory, forget all that deep theory up there. You know, so what works in talking about sort of practical sets of issues in common sense ways was really sort of what, you know, sort of the approach he has. So I had read quite a bit of him, and that's why I became interested in AIER. Now, I should say that I disagree vehemently with many of the positions that Colonel Harwood took and that are often associated with AIER. And so, but that's part of sort of Colonel Harwood's methodology, that he strongly encouraged people to sort of take positions and sort of have a discussion and debate about it. What might be called argument for the sake of heaven. Now, argument for the sake of heaven is not trying to win the argument. You want to win. But the whole purpose of the argument is to further sort of understanding of where people are, so you have a better insight into what's going on. So that is the way within philosophy that sort of truth is found. Now, within economics, we think truth lies in empirical validation. We can do pretty much anything with the data and come up with anything we want, so we're not going to find truth there. Truth is much more complicated than that. And so, you know, I think Colonel Harwood sort of recognized that in the methodology. And so I've been interested sort of in his methodology and sort of looking at that. So even though I disagreed with many of the positions he arrived at, I strongly believe that the method he supported, you know, sort of, and that he advanced, you know, sort of is the right method. And that's why I maintain an interest in AIER. Now, where am I? There's really two reasons why people favor the market. And one is that they want to protect the rich and powerful. The other is they want to protect the poor and vulnerable. And the second group, of which I consider myself, so I'm a market supporter, but I'm a Bernie person at heart. I'm up in Vermont, remember. Is that, you know, sort of, you don't see the government and markets as opposites. You see the two as complements. The only way markets work is if you have a government sort of creating an ecostructure within which they can work. So you don't talk about, here, we'll leave it to the market, because the government's going to get involved in the market. The question is, how is the government going to be involved in the market? Not, is it going to be involved in the market? And very much, I think that's been lost. Sort of when classical economists, sort of Lionel Robbins, who was a famous classical economist, was asked, what is laissez-faire? He says, laissez-faire is the state. And by that he meant, here you have a state in which the goal of the state is to sort of let things work on their own by creating a system in which they can. It's very much a type of parenting. You want your kid to do right good things, but if you tell him you got to do this, ain't no way the kid's going to do it. So what you have to do is sort of let them work it on their own, let them figure it out on their own, and try and guide them that right way. So the type of market person that I am sort of sees it as a guide to try and let it do, and sort of that sort of sense of telling people what to do or structuring it doesn't work. So I'm not against a lot of government policies because I'm not trying to get the goal you have, but I'm against a lot of policies because the way they work out in practice isn't to achieve the ends one wants. And so, you know, the second group is really concerned about government policies, not that they interfere with the market. The concern is it provides a vehicle for the people invested interests, sort of to create ways to prevent the market from working and achieving what you want to do. And this goes long back to Adam Smith, you know, sort of operating there. And, you know, sort of medical care is a perfect example of this. In trying to do good in a whole variety of things, we have created an absolute mess of our healthcare system. And the reason we have isn't because each of the steps hasn't been trying to achieve something better. It's that it's allowed sort of the vested interests to sort of handle it and cover it, and avoids the hard questions that we have to ask. And much of what I'm going to present here is to say, here are two laws I'm suggesting that will force us to answer hard questions that we've wanted to avoid. And healthcare involves some really hard questions of how you're going to do it. But what we have currently is the worst of both situations. And that's where, because we have here, you know, we've allowed sort of the structure to sort of find this middle. And what I'm arguing is there's really two thoughts. But I wanted to have, I always try and have Adam Smith at least once in my lectures. So this is actually, I often have his theory of moral sentiments and report from that. So Adam Smith wrote two books, not just one. The theory of moral sentiments was his philosophical book about how people care about others. The Wealth of Nations was how to achieve caring about others, if you really care about it. And so that, I think, has to be seen. But this is sort of, you know, very much there. So he wrote, and I'll just do the second part of it, the proposal of any new law or regulation of commerce, which comes from this order, and this order is those people in power, okay? From this order, ought always to be listened with great precaution, and ought never to be adopted till after having been long and carefully examined, not only with the most scrupulous, but with the most suspicious attention. It comes from an order of men whose interest is never exactly the same with that of the public, who have generally an interest to deceive and even to oppress the public, and who accordingly have, upon many occasions, both deceived and oppressed. And so, you know, the argument is really here, if we try and do good through government, it gives all kinds of sets of people ways of looking that they're doing good, but doing good not only sort of a little bit of good, but a lot more good for themselves. And sort of finding that combination is really the key to policy. And that's sort of part of the discussion that's been lost. That it sort of seems here, people favor the market, they don't care about people. You know, so people who care about people sort of say, yes, but the way we do it is, in many ways, you've got to be very careful about how you're doing it. So, you know, so what does all this have to do with healthcare? Well, there's really only two answers to healthcare. The middle is not an acceptable answer, and the middle is what we have now. One is a single-payer plan. Now, I'm from Vermont, and a single-payer plan is really possible. And in Colorado, they probably will move to it, and, you know, so that's one way. The single-payer plan works, you know, because it essentially, here's the person who pays, and here's the person who decides, which is government. And it's got to be, you know, the other alternative sort of is often called a market alternative. I don't like calling it a market alternative because it's sort of not a good comparison with that. I argue that the correct comparison is a multi-payer bottom-up system. And a multi-payer relies on individuals to make decisions about what is reasonable, and the individuals to hold costs down, okay? And I don't call it a market system because in a multi-payer system, government has an enormously important role to play in that. Sort of we as a society have decided that here we cannot allow medical care to be allocated by the market. There are people who need it. And what the market says, they can't pay, they die. That's unacceptable. And so therefore, we're going to have it. We've always had sort of that coming in. So that's going to be part of it. And to say the market's going to solve it, that it isn't going to solve that problem. Somehow we have to figure out a way to deal with that problem. The way we've allowed it to be figured out, to be dealt with, is to sort of let the people inside figure it out. And they've structured the system so that healthcare providers sort of do pretty well. But sort of we've lost sight of the track that here what we're really trying to do is achieve low-cost, affordable healthcare that's solid, not Cadillac care, but solid care for everyone. If people want Cadillac care, they can pay for it, as they could in a single-payer system. So a single-payer system would not allow the market. It's just that government is going to pay for it. So you have these two alternatives. Now, what won't work is where costs are non-transparent. And the key to sort of dealing with any sort of healthcare issue is to make what are the costs and are they transparent? And sort of that's necessary for a single-payer plan, and it's necessary for the multiplayer plan. What we currently have, when you take a look at a bill after you've been to a doctor or a hospital, try and figure out what you're actually paying, who you're paying, or how it is. It is impossible. My wife's a doctor, I'm an economist. Between the two of us, we haven't a chance in hell of figuring out what these costs are or anything else. And that's only half of it, because there's a whole nother set of billing issues that are operating on there. So the system has made the cost totally non-transparent. But that's very important if you're part of these vested interests trying to protect your rents. Because if people said, we're not willing to pay these rents, if the costs were transparent. And so, you know, so that's really, you know, so the structure of where the system is now. Now, why are those the two options? Because of the golden rule of economics. What the heck is the golden rule? Whoever has the gold makes the rules. Or put another way, you know, he who pays makes the decisions about how much to get and, you know, what's going on. If you don't have that connection, the system is just going to blow up. And there's no cost controls. So somehow that has to be the case. For that to be the case, costs have to be transparent. You know, so that's really, you know, sort of the main part of it. Now, why these cost containment systems work? When you're paying, you care a lot more about costs. I have a wonderful example in my textbook of a person who was in the hospital, you know, sort of being cared for, you know, sort of, and, you know, sort of, it cost probably about $4,000 a day to have somebody in the hospital. And he was in there for 2 weeks, not getting better. So a doctor came in and examined him and said, really, the problem is you've got the wrong set of dentures. So, you know, sort of it's not solving, you know, helping and sort of keeping it going. And said, you've got to get some more. Why don't you get it? Well, I'd have to pay for that myself. They're not covered by Medicaid. And, you know, so you can indeed do that hundreds of times. I mean, I get so upset when I get doctor's bills. But I get so upset and then I say, well, I have really good health care coverage, so guess what? It sort of ends at me being upset and starting to go there, as opposed to going that next level. I am going to see that something is done about this. If I were paying, something would be done about it. And that's really the key. Now, a single payer system works if we have a group of experts who understand all these things and whose goal is to say, here, we're going to hold costs down. But you've got to be politically really powerful to be able to say, we're not giving you medical care for this because it doesn't make sense. That's really hard to get by politically, and we've structured the system, so that's really hard to do. But the people who favored the single-payer plan knew precisely that what the Affordable Care Act would lead to was not holding down costs. It would lead to more of a mess. But they saw that as a reasonable mess to create, to move to a path that's better. And really, the system was designed to move because the costs are so high, we've got to move to a single-payer system. And that's the system, the path we're on now. If we continue along the way we're doing, we will be at a single-payer system in 5 to 10 years. That's what the sophisticated individuals who supported Obamacare understood. And these are good people. I mean, they care, you know, about achieving the end. So it isn't there, but it's what one had to do in order to get it. Now, the way that meant and what puts it on there is that they put as much cost non-transparency into the system as they possibly could. So they increase cost, because we don't want to say, here, stuff is costing as much as it's costing, because that would get people upset. So we've got to create hidden taxes that will pay some of it, and we have to use accounting procedures in a way that'll make it look that here we're doing a lot of good. So, you know, all those are blended into what's actually happening. Now, what I'm considering today is what will make a multi-payer plan more feasible. And, you know, sort of pretty much without some changes, we're going to be moving to a single-payer plan. And I'm not against a single-payer plan. It works reasonably well in a whole number of countries. You go over in England, you know, sort of most of Europe, you know, so sort of they have lower-cost care that isn't quite as good as the U.S., but for 95% of the people it is, and the other 5% can sort of operate outside the system. So it will work. It's not my favorite plan at all. And I think there's a better plan, which is the multiplayer plan. But without some changes, without cost transparency, you will not have a chance to move to a multi-payer plan. And so those are really the two laws that I'm going to discuss today, which would allow us to move to that. And they're really about, you know, cost issues. Now, the Affordable Care Act decreased, you know, sort of the, really decreased the transparency of costs in the system, both for insurance and for healthcare. You know, so, but we had long ago created non-transparency, and the problem of the US healthcare really goes back to World War II, when we had wage controls. Nothing wrong with wage controls. We don't want people, you know, sort of, when all kinds of people are over fighting, we don't want workers sort of getting there, so we put on wage controls. But we allowed healthcare not to be included in wages. So therefore, all kinds of firms said, here, we want to give our workers something. Healthcare was very inexpensive then. Healthcare workers saw their job as doing God's work. They weren't worried about making money. Hospitals were nonprofit, it was operating there. Here it was fairly cost. We can provide wonderful healthcare for people and do it. And they did. And they got around the wage controls. Well, that sort of set up a system where you had a whole group of people who had health insurance. Insurance is the problem, not the solution. Because if you have insurance, guess what? You're not worried about costs. So it doesn't matter whether government's paying or insurance paying, as long as somebody else is paying, you're still worried a little bit about costs, but nowhere near the degree if it's coming out of your pocket. And that changed the system because it put a whole group of people, you know, so a large, you know, actually majority of people having health insurance, that's created another group who are outs. They didn't have health insurance. And so the care system before, which everyone worked because everyone faced it and held costs down, no longer worked. And so we've got it, one group of people, sort of which most of you are part. We have wonderful health insurance and one health care, and we're in pretty good shape. You have another group of people who are outside the system, and they're in really bad shape. And sort of the Affordable Care Act was saying, we've got to do something about this. But it said, what we've got to do is get insurance for them too. But insurance is part of the problem, so getting insurance for them too is going to make the system worse. And so the problem was sort of saying, it's an insurance problem, as opposed to a cost and accessibility problem. And sort of, if you see it as a cost and accessibility problem, the question is, how can you change that? Well, to do that, I have two laws that I'm suggesting. Okay, they're fairly short laws, and I'll discuss the implications of them. The first one I call the Fair Health Care Pricing Act. That sounds good, doesn't it? Individuals paying for their own health care will pay no more than the price paid by the equivalent health for the equivalent health care by a large insurance company or by government. Okay? So what does that mean? Well, let's say you suddenly don't have insurance or anything else. And you go in and say, I have to go to the emergency room, I have to go to spend a day in the hospital. What will it cost you? An arm and a leg is more than that. You know, because you will be assigned almost all the overhead, possibly. Now, when you go in and have an insurance company, so let's say for 3 days it would cost you $20,000 if you don't have insurance. Okay? If you have insurance, they will bill the insurance company for $20,000, but they will charge the insurance company, there will be this adjustment and everything else, maybe $4,000. Of course, if you have a copay, they'll figure it on the other one, so you'll pay more, but that's a separate issue. Okay, so how about Medicaid or Medicare? What will they pay? Well, they don't want to pay the overhead either. So they'll pay maybe $3,000 for the total amount. So the person without insurance ends up paying $20,000. The other people pay much lower rates. Now, that says it's really, really expensive an insurance problem. You know, sort of, and we've got to do something about that. But if you look at sort of the price structure of how it works and the cost system, you know, sort of there. So let's, you know, so if we're moving there, healthcare costs are almost, you know, a large part overhead costs. So what you have are large amounts of overhead, and sort of here are your incremental costs, which are relatively low. Now, textbooks usually talk as if incremental costs really cover overhead. They don't in all kinds of areas, including AIER, you know, so you have large amounts of overhead that you somehow have to figure out, how do we allocate these costs? Now, the way economics works, so economic theory works, is with the Ramsey inverse elasticity assignment rule. Now, that's a real mess and everything else. But, you know, sort of essentially it says here you have different type people. People who really need it and people who don't. People who really need something have an inelastic demand. People who don't really need it have an elastic demand. So you assign all the overhead costs to those who really need it. Now, in the normal economic market, the people who really need it and are willing to pay for it are the rich. And so the rich get assigned all the overhead costs. And the poor, you know, sort of get to come along just for the marginal costs. That's the way the system is designed to do it if you have a market operating. So Joseph Strumpeter, you know, sort of pointed this long ago when he said the capitalist achievement does not typically consist of bringing more silk stockings for the queens, but to making them within reach of working girls. That essentially sort of here we can get the rich to pay for almost all the overhead. And then, you know, sort of we have, you know, so the poor people, they can come along. It works. Think of airlines. First class, $7,000. $200 back in, you know, sort of the cattle car. But, you know, sort of, and there's variations of that. But the overhead gets assigned to really those sets of people who, you know, sort of have the money. Now, if you have a good, that really you've decided people can't go without, you can have need without income, there's a role for government there. You've got to have government entering in. And so healthcare isn't like that. But notice it would have been, and it really worked like that before. But once we've created insurance, that changes it because now overhead costs are allocated by bargaining power, not by sort of how inelastic a person's demand are. Well, the rich and insurance companies and government have much more bargaining power than the poor, who don't have insurance. So the poor get assigned much higher overhead than the rich. This is perverse. The poor who actually pay for the healthcare, it's awful, because they're subsidizing a whole group of other people. Now, a lot of poor, the largest cause of bankruptcy in the US is healthcare. So a lot of poor say, you know, you're giving a $70,000 bill. You know, how the hell am I going to pay that? You know, I've got to declare bankruptcy. But even that, you know, hospitals know that's going to happen. And there's sort of, they know they'll get sort of, there's an adjustment that government makes for sort of written off bills. So they write off the $70,000 and they get reimbursed 10 to 20% for that. Well, 70,000, 10 to 20, that's, you know, 7 to 14,000. That's more than what they, you know, that's more than what they would have gotten from the other. So it's worthwhile to continue the system to make it next to impossible that individuals pay their own healthcare costs. But the key to the multi-payer plan is that individuals pay their own healthcare costs. And so what this law is designed to do is to bring that back. And sort of to say, here, You can't assign overhead costs on the basis of that. We're going to see that people who don't have insurance only pay that same amount. So we've changed the bargaining power considerably. And in the process, made it worthwhile for a lot of people to say, I don't need or want insurance. Because here it's probably worthwhile for me to be able to pay this on my own. So that change would have an enormous difference in terms of the structure of how many people would choose to sort of self-insure for things. Now, for major things, you'd be very likely to self-insure. Okay, so it would come back to insurance what it was designed to be, which is for catastrophic types of activities. Okay, but here for normal activities, you'd have that. And in some ways, the Affordable Care Act is bringing that back. If you take a look at the, you know, sort of bronze plan, where the first, you know, $4,000, $5,000 is essentially, you know, sort of, you have to pay. That makes a lot of healthcare, you know, there. And it's changing the structure of it. What this would do is sort of allow that to sort of operate and more, because as opposed to these people being charged these enormous high amounts that push you up immediately, you get charged the low amount. So you have an awful lot of healthcare most people would never, ever reach sort of the level where they actually need it. Okay? So what we get with that change is an army of cost controllers who are out there because people paying their own way will say, here, this isn't the most reasonable way of giving a care. It'd be a lot better. Do I want to spend $25 for this Band-Aid that they're charging me? Can I bring in my own Band-Aid? And a variety of things. The pressure would be put on suppliers to really hold costs down in a way that it isn't now. And so that's sort of the key in terms of a multiplayer plan. Now, the second law I call the Fair Health Insurance Pricing Law. And that is that individuals should not be required by government regulation to pay more than the actuarial cost of their health insurance. Okay, so let me repeat that. Individuals should not be required by government regulation to pay more than the actuarial costs of their health insurance. But what the hell are actuarial costs? To do that, we sort of have to think, what's the purpose of insurance? The purpose of insurance is to spread risk among people who have roughly similar risk characteristics. So really, it's how to cover random events that occur. Okay? The way we've structured the system now is everyone, the government insurance companies have to charge everyone the same price. Well, the actuarial cost is, if you have a really healthy young person, the actuarial costs of insuring that person are very low. If you have somebody like me, old, you know, falling apart, the costs, actuarial costs of insuring me are really high. But if we both have to pay the same amount, what we've done is create a tax on the healthy, whether they're rich or poor, which subsidizes the individuals who are unhealthy, whether they're rich or poor. So you get the perverse effect that poor, healthy people end up subsidizing rich, unhealthy people within the system itself. This law is designed to stop that and say, here, the insurance companies can calculate the actuarial costs, and they do it all the time, for groups of individuals. That's the highest you can pay, or you can charge them. That would probably lower the costs for all kinds of individuals, you know, sort of like 40, 50, 60% of individuals, to much lower than what it is now for insurance. Even without the subsidies that government's getting, a lot more people could afford it. It would raise the rates for a lot of other people enormously, beyond what? And you've got to cover both, but it's just currently we hide how we're paying for that. We hide the costs of what the insurance are, and this is to make those costs explicit. It is really, really expensive to provide health care for us older people. And, you know, somehow that's got to be paid for and figured out. But we'd be bargaining a lot more if we were paying it for ourselves, or those sets of people who are going to be covered by that, which is probably about 20-25%, not the 100% of the population. That 20-25% probably moves to something very similar to a single-payer plan. You know, where government is covering your costs, so government is making decisions and doing the bargaining power for you, because when you're really sick and as you get, you know, there's no way you can sort of do the bargaining, so you want that. So you still have this expert single-payer system, but not for everybody. Only for those set of people, you know, sort of whom, you know, can't afford it on their own. And so what you do is sort of parse the system somewhat differently. Okay, so that most people now under this law would say insurance isn't very expensive and healthcare isn't very expensive because we've taken a lot of the overhead costs from them and they're no longer subsidizing paying for the unhealthy. So that 60%, that's fine. That's sort of the market system. That's the multi-payer system. They all serve to hold costs down. The other part sort of operates through government, you know, in much the same way that we have. So it move with Medicaid, Medicare, sort of expanding, you know, in variations on that. But you'll only get that as an alternative if we move towards these much more transparent costs and pricing of insurance. If we don't have those transparencies and that changes in sort of how it works, we're on the path to a single payer plan for everyone as opposed to just some subset. And so that's what I think the law, you know, so really is at issue there. Now I have a bunch that I can talk about sort of the actuarial costs and that, but you know, so what happens is that here, sort of individuals sort of would be, the law sort of specifies now that regardless of pre-existing conditions, anything else, sort of here you have to be charged. That's why they were hoping so much that all kinds of young people stepped in. The young people who stepped in, 85% of them are being subsidized. Okay, sort of, you know, sort of that's, you know, that's the only way you got them to step in. If you had very little income. Those with income now get stuck in the worst possible situation because they have to pay higher, much higher costs than what it would cost them for insurance. And when they buy health care, they have to pay much higher costs than that, than what they'd pay in sort of a normal market system. So the goal here really is to try and move towards that direction. Now, just one, some concluding comments. That these measures clearly are not panaceas for anybody. I'm not saying I have the solution to healthcare or anything else. They're much more to get us thinking about what the issues are. That somehow, if we're going to have cost containment, the group paying has to have the power of decisions about the type of care that's going to be provided. Unless that connection is there, you know, costs are just going to continue to rise, and because there's nobody stopping them. So that can be done with a single-payer plan where you have experts. And, you know, so I've been looking a lot at sort of the English system, how it works, their National Health Service, you know, so where they have a board of experts. And, of course, I'm an academic, so all experts think we know all kinds of things. And, you know, so it works reasonably well, but experts have real problems, too. That we lose sight of, you know, sort of a whole set of issues that people on the ground sort of understand an issue. You can't help but sort of have sort of individuals understand what they need much better than what somebody else thinks they need. And then even if somebody else can figure it out better, you still want to be able to make that decision. It's inherent in us that we like control over that. And we're going to lose that control as part of it. And so the multiplayer plan sort of allows that control to sort of maintain to the degree it can. But there's sets of people who are actuarial, and that means sort of in a probabilistic sense what it'll cost, really, really expensive to insure. Now, those before were handled by a medical care system whose goal was not profit, whose goal was what I call for benefit. You know, so they took their goal as sort of providing good health care to people, and we want a decent wage, but that's it. Once we shifted it to for profit, trying to get as much as you possibly can, you undermine the entire system. So drug care, you know, sort of there, is sort of here. What can they charge for drugs? Well, pretty much anything. What would people pay for drugs? A lot less. But we need the money to do research. Well, number one, there's only a small percentage that's spent on research. And number two, you know, sort of here is research that, you know, sort of you've been paid for. Why are you now sort of getting it in and then get new things there? So there's lots of other things that would have to change if we're going to get cost containment. And indeed, I think, you know, sort of you'd find large number of changes in sort of patents, you know, sort of for drugs, how they're allocated and how drug prices are. You know, sort of that would have to change. So that if you look at TV, everything is an advertisement for drugs. Of course, what's going on there? What's going on there is it's not an advertisement, here's the best drug for you. It's here's the drug at which we get this enormous profit margin on versus the other one. If you were, people were making their own decisions, that wouldn't be, but as long as you passed it off to somebody else, it's not there. So all those changes would have to be made. But we'll only start making them if we make the costs and prices transparent. And that's why I sort of end up with these two laws as the beginning point to start a debate, to start an argument for the sake of heaven of which of the two are better. We're not debating should we do it. We're debating how best to do it. And that's the way I think we should be thinking about moving forward with the healthcare debate. So thank you. Happy to take questions. Yes.
Which countries have a multi-payer system?
None.
Multi-payer system.
None.
And what are some of the drawbacks of the single-payer system? For example, in Sweden, you don't get a heart transplant, right?
Right. In other words, they'll make decisions. Here's reasonable care. Okay. And if what you're getting isn't reasonable care, they haven't decided is there. You won't get it covered. And they're given strict budget guidelines that they have to stay within. So there's a hard budget constraint that they have to have. And you have to accept. So sometimes for a lot of elective surgery or surgery, there can be 2-3 year waiting lists. You know, so it can be a long time. And you can get lots of horror stories sort of coming out, but they're reasonable, you know, when you think of it, of what's going there. But the real cost is somebody else is making that decision for you. When you're sick, you like to be able to have some control over the decisions, and you have to give a lot of that up with that. So that's why I think, you know, so if it's possible, and politically, you need cover for those experts. Here in the US, we don't have cover for them. So if you notice, when they started with Obamacare talking about these boards of experts, death panels. People are going to decide to give people counseling that do we really, you know, want to sort of extend your life forever, you know, as long as possible, or do we want, you know, some reasonable decision to be made that you would make? Notice there that became not allowed in the US. To the degree you can't have those discussions, you can't have cost control within the single payer system. Okay, so that's really, you know, so what's that issue? Ben?
I have two things on this single payer system. Medicare works, basically. I really believe that's what we should have for everyone, mm-hmm. with government fighting for control of costs, negotiating drug costs, negotiating hospital costs. As you know, Medicare pays 80%. If you choose to, you can get a supplemental. So the same way If you can't get a heart, you go out. If you can't get a heart operation, because the board says we're not going to cover that, you can get a supplemental.
Right.
And therefore, you're spreading your risks over the large U.S. population. I see a lot of problems with your multi-payer. I really don't see any big problems with single payer.
Okay, let me try and explain sort of the issue you said. Here, Medicare and Medicaid, you know, sort of provides reasonable care for lots of people. But one of the ways they do it is to drive really hard bargains with providers, which means here you have all these overhead costs. They get assigned to all the people who don't have insurance. So what you've done is sort of push the costs, these other costs, onto other people. So what the law would change here would just push it back and say Medicare actually is costing 40, 50% more than what we currently have it budgeting for. And sort of health insurance for older people is actually costing 6 times as much as what we say it is. So we've made the costs hidden. And you know, sort of that's the problem.
But once you're spreading it out, because you're of every citizen is paying it. It's being spread out over millions and millions. I don't know, whatever, 300 million, whatever we are. So that it's really with the government negotiating. So the costs are going to be figured in. It's still going to be cheaper than your multi-payer system, the way I see it. Look what's happening right now with Obamacare. The costs are going off the wall. And people are dropping it because they can't afford it.
But that's because of the way it's designed with these hidden taxes sort of structured in it. So in other words, insurance, what you're saying, it spreads it out among everybody. It's supposed to spread it out among everybody who has the equivalent actuarial costs. So here, individuals who, you know, a set of individuals who are sort of a normal group, all of whom are healthy. If you say here, healthy individuals, their costs are down here. There's another group of people whose costs are very high. Now, what you're doing by saying everyone has to pay the same insurance rates, you're taxing the healthy, whether they're poor or not, to subsidize the unhealthy, whether they're rich or not. Now, I'm not arguing against subsidizing, you know, the unhealthy. But the question is, I'm saying it shouldn't be hidden in sort of what the pricing is. It should be explicit. We are doing it, and here is what it is costing us to do. And currently, we're hiding that cost within sort of the pricing system and within the insurance system. And that's what I'm trying to say. If we want an honest discussion of what the issues are, we can't hide the costs. And that's all I'm saying. Yes?
Many people say that Medicare eventually is going to go bankrupt. And if we're hiding costs in that calculation, isn't it going to go bankrupt sooner?
No. In other words, you know, it isn't going to go bankrupt. You know, sort of, because, you know, so we'll get some money somehow to pay for it. What I'm saying is with insurance, there's hidden taxes. The reason a lot of people aren't getting insurance is because, you know, so healthy people aren't getting insurance is because they have to pay a tax on that. And that's a different issue. But no, you know, we will provide the money to sort of...
That assumes that the public will be willing to pay the price, which is going to be a lot higher than what they're paying today.
No, under the changes I'm making aren't sort of ones that are, you know, sort of lowering, you know, changing the price. They're just getting people to say, here's what the costs are. Once those costs are, then we can start talking about how things will change. So it isn't going to push it up or not. It's just going to change who's paying and what things really cost. Because unless you know what things cost, you can't make reasonable decisions about how to handle it. And currently, the structure of the system is designed so that nobody knows the cost. And so therefore, the people who are providing it can really sort of jack those prices up. And so I'm just arguing for transparency. The next set of debates would be between a single payer and a multi-payer plan. But I'm saying that debate will only be a reasonable debate if we have transparent about what the costs are, okay? Yes?
You mentioned transparency. About a month ago on NBC News, they highlighted a company who, where you can go, like if you need a colonoscopy, you can go and then get the prices of area providers and then select one that's available at a lower rate. Do you have any idea how that company is doing?
It's doing quite well. Because of sort of, there's a group of people who have to pay their own way. But the reason it's doing well is because we have a group of people. If we had a much larger group of people, it would take off enormously and do it. There's also a whole set of things. It is worthwhile when you need operations to combine it with a vacation. To India, sort of all kinds of places where you can pay for the entire vacation, get the operation with US-trained doctors, by the way, and fly back, at less than what you'd pay if you're paying yourself. So those would become very much part of the discussion in a multi-payer system. So they're there, but they're only on the fringes because we've designed the system so it can't work. So if a hospital, so what if an insurance company said, I want to use the lowest cost payer? They wouldn't be allowed. Okay, so in other words, if the insurance company says, here, we're going to use this, no, look what you're doing to us. You're sending us to a low quality place. Whereas people making their own decisions will make the decisions about quality. So because the debate becomes so heated so fast, it's impossible to have somebody else doing it unless you're paying it yourself. You can make those decisions. Somebody else can't for you. If they try to, you'll structure it in a way that makes them look awful.
Okay.
Yes?
I was wondering how your tool is going to incorporate preventive care?
Again, preventive care would be one that I'd expect, sort of would continue to exist. You could have sort of, if you decide that you want preventive care for everybody, you could have some preventive care just for everybody. But preventive care could be very low cost. So that individuals could get. And if it were low cost, they weren't being assigned a lot of the overhead cost. Walmart started providing drugs at extraordinarily low rates. You could have clinics, a whole variety of clinics that could provide basic health, sort of preventive care for everyone. Those changes would be made if we had individuals paying their own way, sort of looking here, how can you provide that in a competitive system? Currently, it doesn't happen because sort of once insurance has it, then insurance, given the political structure, has to pay, sort of here, let people choose. So we have insurance, plus we can't push too hard on telling individuals what to do. And sort of if insurance, sort of the single payer is going to work, we've got to accept that we're going to have more restrictions on that. Yes.
So one of the interesting things that came out at the same time as the Affordable Care Act had all these marketplaces. So people were being told, you can choose the price point you want to pay for. This, pretty much the same time, private sector employers are being offered these exchanges, these private sector exchanges. And so instead of General Electric having one healthcare plan, and I'm not sure if GE has these, but I'll use an example, they're designing a program where the company would have a variety of options of networks, and you could pick, and they would pay you, the company would give you the money for the premium, and you go figure out where you want to buy basically within their network. Now, what's happening is that the employee is now deciding where to put their healthcare dollar, but also what seems to be interesting is the hospitals that want to be in the network are competing to lower their costs, so the employer puts them in the network. Have you had a chance to see any of that?
Yeah, I followed that, man, but notice what this does. It sort of undermines the whole network structure. So in other words, if you're forced to pay somebody without insurance to charge no more than what you do the lowest price provider, you've undermined the whole network structure. So the network structure is designed in many ways sort of around the system and sort of to allocate these overhead costs. And that sort of means here, to the degree you get the network, we've bargained there, you sort of limit it elsewhere. What would make more sense is sort of to say here, face, you know, sort of wherever. The network's the entire system. And the entire system sort of going to have lower costs. And there can be competition within that. But it'll be competition among individuals, not within networks. Because the networks operate in such a way that there's a whole nother group sort of who's figuring this out and how it's operating there. And so it depends on the bargaining power of somebody else.
You raised the question before about insurance company. You have to be careful with telling people what type of doctor or who they can go to. But the largest growing group of insurance is HMOs. And they very clearly exclude the higher priced doctors, the ones who have the higher, they most, and that is government employees, individuals, Medicare, the, so therefore, they are in a way telling you, if you choose not to use that doctor, their system doctor, you can go outside the system and pay whatever you want. But an HMO very clearly says, this is the doctors you must use, be it a heart operation or anything else. So I'm just refuting your argument that insurance companies can be strong enough to say, this is it. You don't like it? Go outside.
Again, it's possible Kaiser has, you know, an HMO system that, you know, is really impressive. And that, and if you go back to the 70s, so when I first looked at this, HMOs, it looked like they were going to really sort of be the way in which we provided it. It sort of provided a reasonable way of doing it, you know, sort of there, and it's something we could have moved to. We didn't move to that. Kaiser actually tried to move out here to the East Coast. They sort of set up a system sort of operating here, and they failed miserably. They had to pull out with their tail between their legs because sort of the way the system worked here, they didn't have control of the hospitals, and what they got charged by the hospitals undermined their whole structure. And so my wife, you know, worked for Kaiser, and, you know, sort of they were gone within a year, you know, so because that system didn't work. And so in California, you know, it works reasonably well. And so that's there. I'm not saying, you know, sort of here, you know, these are the type discussions that I think should be one should be having. But they're saying all these systems are possible and everything else. What are the costs? What are the benefits? How do they work and what goes on there? And, you know, sort of I'm just saying here within the discussion I'm hearing, sort of these two issues about costs are really not sort of part of the discussion, and I think they should be. And I think they move the argument more towards where a multiplayer system, payer system makes sense. It doesn't mean that's the argument for it. There's a much more complicated argument for it, but I want sort of the sort of level playing field for the discussion to take place. And that's what I'm arguing for. Yes.
Now, this population of younger, presumably somewhat healthier people who would be non-insured, would be done buying their health care directly in this multi-payer system we're discussing, isn't there a great risk that they would simply, because of other costs that they face, just not get health care, that there would go a lot of undiagnosed illnesses would go on for a long time before it becomes so clear that they...
I think yes, but the question, we can debate, sort of how much help doctors do in sort of a whole variety. My wife's a doctor, so, you know, so it isn't there. But, you know, sort of probably half the people who go to a doctor, what you need is sort of reassurance on something. You don't need, you know, sort of a lot of things. You'd like information. There's all kinds of things with telemarketing or with telemedicine that you can sort of have where you can call up and sort of have, which are prevented now, you know, sort of by whole sets of rules and regulations. That could sort of be operating there. So I'm not saying people shouldn't have that. But healthy people, for the most part, young, you know, sort of, they don't go to the doctor whether they have to. It's a pain to go to the doctor. So it isn't so much, you know, it's one, expensive. But this would make it much less expensive if they're paying, out of their own pocket, but here it's a much, you know, lower rate. In other words, say I have a mole. If I have a mole there, I wonder if it's cancer. Well, first I go to my, sort of just physician and says, well, I really can't tell you, but I can assign you something else. There's $140 first. Now I go to a specialist who goes and says, well, it sort of looks like it isn't, but it isn't, but I can biopsy it. Now it's $3,000. I'm going there. Now I can do that and have done it. It's $3,000. It goes there. Or, you can have somebody who's doctors, normal doctor gets one lecture on moles, through their medical school. That's as much as they get. You could have a mole specialist that you could go to. And this person is not a doctor, but they have really looked at moles and have a telemedicine doctor that they can consult in other cases. You go to them, they charge you $15 and say 99.9%, that's just something, so that you don't have to worry about. We don't have that type of system because people are not paying their own way. If people were paying their own way, we'd develop a whole set of ways of reasonably handling the healthcare questions that people have. And currently, so the way that we've designed the system, which makes it so expensive, if ever you're going to go through the system, it forces it to where you have to have insurance, and then if you don't have insurance, you don't get it. So this would make it for those sets of people who don't have insurance, either because of choice or not, it's a lot cheaper, and in those cases where they consider it necessary, they would. Now, if we want more, so preventative care, we can say government will provide something, some amount. So that's still part of the debate. But sort of that sort of individuals making decisions on their own sort of is currently prevented because of the structure of the system. Yes?
What is the percentage cost of generally administrative costs? Like within insurance companies, it seems like every insurance company has its own set of rules and regulations. Doctors' offices have to hire multiple people to deal with all the different insurance companies because there's no
truly awful. Yes.
And the other thing is, how much are we all paying extra in our healthcare because people sue? And, part of the mole problem is because everybody is not giving 100% assurance that this is not going to be cancerous, and so everybody's just willing to mold.
Because somebody else is paying the cost. In other words, so we would deal with it if one were paying the cost themselves. If I had to pay $3,000 to get it, get that decision, I would say something's got to change. And sort of entrepreneurs would recognize something's got to change and would figure out here's an inexpensive way to provide this, of just what they need. But currently, regulations, sort of the structure of the system prevents all that from happening. So most of it is trying to fit the insurance company sort of there. Insurance payments is as bad as sort of government sort of as a third payer. So it's the key is the individual getting it pays. So insurance was the reason we sort of made it. So we moved away from that. So think of insurance as the problem, not as the solution, because insurance sort of creates means somebody else is paying. Now, it works if it's just random. So the way insurance is designed to be, car insurance works. There's different risk pools. And if you're in a high risk pool, we have ways you can still buy insurance. The government, requires insurance companies to provide it, but it's sort of provided in a separate way. And that's what I'm saying would happen here. That for most people, insurance costs would go down probably 50, 60%, for most people. Other ones that increase enormously, and government would have to come in and pay. So government would still end up paying, but it's just how they're saying it's paying. Here, we're not providing subsidies to these poor people. We're actually taxing them, to support somebody else. And so it's changing that. Yes?
You mentioned it before you started your talk, sir, that you're not a politician. And so, but in order to write the system a little bit in the terms that you're talking about, isn't it going to take some sort of political movement? We're all in the midst of the presidential campaigns. We hear all these this and that and the other thing. Isn't it going to take a political?
Absolutely. In other words, I'm an academic, as I said. I'm sort of you know, worry about these broad issues and everything else. I'm not saying these laws are ready to bring up. I've talked to some candidates, you know, but I do not have the stomach to get into sort of the politics and everything else. What I've argued is here there's some good talking points and arguments that some politicians might be able to fit into their structure. But that is a total another area of specialty of which I have don't claim to have any expertise and don't want to have any expertise in. The solution has to be politics, you know, because, you know, that's how we make decisions. So the fact that I can't do politics doesn't mean that I don't recognize it's very important. It just means, number one, I don't enjoy it. Number two, I'm not good at it. And so, therefore, I do what I'm reasonably good at, which is sort of talk about broad issues, raising questions, and hope that sort of by generating sort of thought, you know, so you stimulate some other people to possibly do something.
You use the example of car insurance as a system that works, but there it's mandatory.
Yeah.
And I don't see how we can have a discussion of this sort without ever mentioning adverse selection.
Yeah, I don't, again, once you have, you know, sort of, once insurance, the mandatory insurance that we currently have includes this tax on healthy individuals. So in other words, the mandatory aspect of insurance, of, you know, health insurance, would be much easier to stomach if no one were charged more than the actuarial cost of the insurance for them. So currently, you know what it is, here you have to get insurance, and what we're charging you for that insurance, even if you have very little income, is this includes this tax, which is subsidizing these other people. And so the mandatory aspect I have no problem with if, you know, sort of here, no one's paying more than their actuarial costs for the insurance. Yes?
I want to go back to your proposals. I'm basically with you in your first proposal. The second proposal, what I'm concerned about is that it's, I'd like you to talk more about what you consider to be the actuarial cost of insurance, because it seems to me that that as a society, we've made the decision to really spread out risk. Now, if you're talking about the actuarial cost of insurance, I live in the Upper West Side of Manhattan. I used to be young, not young anymore, but you know, as a society, I view myself as being willing to subsidize the cost of insurance for someone in the South Bronx, which has, you know, the highest rates of asthma and diabetes in the world. That's a societal issue. And so what you're suggesting you rise to many issues such as sex discrimination, racial discrimination, you know.
There's all sets of issues.
Could you talk a bit
about what
you consider actuarial?
What I, you know, again, actuarial costs brought down to the individual level is next to impossible. You know, so you can have it. And there's legal rules about what you can consider and what you can't consider for discrimination issues and everything else. What I'm saying is you can divide up the population probably into four or five groups. And that's sort of the way it's done with, you know, car insurance. So here, different people have different amounts. But here, these are relatively similar people, you know, sort of who, you know, so within a range, fall within the same range. And they then would sort of be charged a certain amount. Here you get other ones, so you get the high risk pool, you know, sort of operating there. And there used to be that in health insurance, you know, sort of a high risk pool. And the high risk pool had higher rates. So you'll get these probably four or five differences, and that's what it would be. So I fully understand, you know, you can't have it down to the individual. But you will have it where there's a set of young people now, you know, sort of young, poor people who are buying insurance. And that insurance, because they're subsidizing sort of these other sets. And that's what I want to stop. And sort of for them, it would lower the cost. And it's really there. And so what you actually work out is something that's much more reasonable than every individual. But, you know, sort of it's there. Just trying to say here, these individuals, you shouldn't say you're getting a subsidy from government when actually you're subsidizing somebody else for that insurance. I think that's perverse. And it's sort of politically something you can say. And here it gets lowered then for them, and then you sort of force people to say, it's costing us much more to provide this care for me and people like me who are getting older. And we better figure out a way. HMOs would probably be a good way to provide it. And if people don't want it, then they can sort of go there. So I'm not against sort of variations on that. But as for what group of people are we talking about, I'm suggesting there's about 60 or 70% of the people who do fine in a multiplayer plan. You know, there's, you know, and then there's about 30% who won't. And we should design and sort of structure the thing for the 30%, not for the 100%, and bring it all in. Because structuring it for the 100% is really designed to sort of keep the revenues coming in for the vested interests who are sort of very much within medical care now. I think at that, thank you very much.